Today, the port of Oakland opens its harbor to fleets of many lands, making this the hub of a trade and transportation network that spans the globe. The Silicon Valley draws visitors from countries hoping to capture the key to our innovative spirit and success. Our Bay Area is international, with sister cities from Caracas to Shanghai. There's no doubt the whole world looks to our home for ideas, for commerce, for peace. I'm Sylvia Chase.
This Bay Area Minute, KRON-TV. It's Friday night. Now, a special presentation from KRON-TV.
Chances are, cause I was...
Sit back. Relax. We're going for a ride. Back to a time that wasn't too long ago. Yet back to a place that in so many ways was very different than it is today. Back to San Francisco in the 1950s.
Dreaming, I'm always dreaming.
We remember the 1950s like one big home movie. For many of us, the decade after World War II was our childhood.
Searching.
For everybody else, it just seemed like one. The 50s were a lot of fun.
Open.
It was a time when America had just won the big war, and we were ready for our prize, a bright and promising future. The Bay Area experienced a great migration then to the new suburbs, while the city went big league. Sure, there was war in Korea, and the Russians, and the bombs to worry about, but there was so much else. And increasingly, San Francisco was a big part of it.
Good evening. I'm Evan White. So, San Francisco in the 1950s is really the story of our city growing up at a time when most of us were doing the very same thing, which is why this show may seem like one big home movie. But it should also explain how San Francisco grew from something of a Western outpost to a major American city.
San Francisco in the 50s is brought to you by Chevron and high-octane Chevron Supreme Unleaded, the high-performance premium gasoline with Tecraline. Chevron Supreme, yes. And by Nissan, who invites you to see the complete line of Nissan cars and trucks at your nearest Nissan dealer. Nissan, built for the most important race of all, the human race. And by Swanson Frozen Foods. When you're not home cooking, Swanson is.
Our story actually begins in 1945, VJ Day, the end of 4 years of war and 10 years of depression before that, the biggest party this city has ever thrown. But if we'd stopped long enough to look around that August afternoon, we might not have recognized our city. Hundreds of thousands of GIs had fallen in love with San Francisco and the weight of the war in the Pacific. When they returned home, they returned to stay. By 1950, the city's population was the largest it's ever been, nearly 800,000 people. For native San Franciscans like newspaper columnist Herb Kane, the city would never be the same.
The city was much more crowded, and of course there was this great influx of people who were strangers in a way, and had been admitted into our charmed circle. And we watched them warily, and they looked at us and wondered what to do to become real San Franciscans. So there was the atmosphere was completely different than it had been when we had the sort of club-like atmosphere.
The city's new atmosphere more resembled the stock exchange. This was the era of the man in the gray flannel suit, when San Francisco, like the rest of the country, enjoyed what the war had left behind. The most productive economy on Earth. Never before, Life magazine declared, so much for so few. Cars, kitchen, hardware, readyware, so many new things to buy, and everything with a fresh sense of fashion and style. And while these men met at the corner of Commercial and Montgomery to do battle in the boardrooms, their wives were shopping at elegant Union Square. More than almost any place else in the 1950s, Union Square became the center of San Francisco's newfound wealth. Fashionable stores lined the streets,
ready to turn the city's ladies into models of the new American style.
Marilyn Monroe, Audrey Hepburn, Natalie Wood, Kim Novak, those were all the new stars, and they were the trendsetters. And for
Lee Bledsoe, Mr. Lee to his ladies, chose Union Square for his salon.
Gina Lola Brigida brought in the Italian cut, which just swept the United States. It was so popular. And everybody had the little curls here. Up to that time, women didn't really have a lot of clothes. They made their own clothes at home. World War II, Korean War was right behind it. So we didn't have the materials. It was a wonderful era. It was a good feeling era.
So much for so few. And it wasn't only at Union Square. In the farmlands and fruit orchards south of town, the American dream was breaking new ground.
Little boxes on the hillside. Little boxes made of ticky-tacky. Little boxes on the hillside. Little boxes all the same.
By the time Malvina Reynolds wrote Little Boxes in 1961, her Ballad of Daly City, the boom was over. At their peak, developers like Dolger, Eichler, and Gellert turned out 20 new homes a day. For many, like Bunny and Ken Gillespie, the newest family outing was going to see the little boxes being built. And maybe, as they did in 1950, finding the right empty lot for a dream house.
And I remember it very clearly because it was the day which we found out was the incursion over the 38th parallel in Korea. And we had looked at these things before and seen that the price at that time was $9,250 for a two-bedroom, one-bath home. And this supposedly was the last street in Broadmoor to be developed, but we've discovered maybe 30 other people who bought the last house also.
Yeah.
So it was part of the sales gimmick.
But one of the things we liked was that it was an aura of being sort of, you know, quasi-rural, and it was
ranging country. Well, we were in the country. There was nothing south of us that was inhabited.
It was a dairy farm out here.
One of the big things that we would do on a Saturday or a Sunday was to come out and see the progress of the house that was being built. And everybody was doing the same thing because you would meet your prospective neighbors.
They were all exactly like we were.
Yeah.
There were young people who, you know, the fellows had been in the war, and most of them had brand new babies. That ours was 6 months old when we moved in was not at all unusual. Everybody on the block had a six-month-old baby. We shared a lot of problems, a lot of how-to and that sort of thing. And we all got along
famously. The concrete, the fences, the grass, everybody was talking about peat moss.
Uh-huh. We did a lot of at-home entertaining.
We were all 25 years old.
My thing was I made tuna and noodles. And I still do. But I don't make as often anymore. We would have tuna and noodles about three times a week because it was one of the few things I knew how to make. I could make that and Spanish rice.
And it was very warm. It was cozy because we felt interdependent.
It really was a terrific time. Yeah.
And then in 1952 or so, television came in.
Uh-huh.
And things did change.
Yeah. Hello, San Francisco. This is Ed Morrow in New York. Just stand by. We'll be with you.
In September of 1951, the television cable from New York to San Francisco was completed. Finally, the West Coast joined nationwide TV. In the 2 years that followed, television ownership grew 40-fold, ending up in 70% of all homes.
Thanks a million.
That year, Milton Berle was still king of Tuesday night.
Oh, shut up!
Even though vaudeville shows were on their way out, variety hours were the thing. Like Ed Sullivan and Arthur Godfrey, and family comedies.
Hey, you look pretty sharp this morning.
Oh, thanks, Bob.
Yes, you certainly do.
Yeah, sharp as a meatball.
Nobody asked you, Ricky.
Now, here were the true stories of our time, beamed directly into our living rooms with situations that mirrored our daily life and characters that did what we did, like watch TV.
Television parties. What else?
You want to come over and watch TV type of thing. It was very, very exciting.
We always
because it wasn't on all the time.
But the television parties were weird and wonderful. You didn't talk. You didn't move. I mean, if your youngster cried, you would hold them on the lap, hope they would go to sleep. Mm-hmm. And you were absolutely mesmerized by this fascinating medium.
Big evening out? Leaving your children with no dinner?
You think they'll go to the trouble of preparing a complete meal for themselves?
They don't have to. Swanson's already done it.
As much as anything, television changed our lifestyles, but it also changed our lives. On the night of January 19th, 1953, nearly three-quarters of our TVs were tuned to a special episode of I Love Lucy. The next day, we all watched President Eisenhower's inauguration. In two wildly different circumstances, only hours apart, we have been united by the image on the tube. But the image could divide. Senator Joseph McCarthy's image would become one of the most familiar and disturbing of the decade. In 1954, the spectacle of his investigation into the Communist Party was shown live every day. His was the face of a growing paranoia, and it gripped the nation. When we come back, a look at the Red Scare in San Francisco in the 1950s.
Ranging cameras of Movietone News bring you the top stories of the year in the cavalcade of 1953.
If you went to the movies in the 1950s, it was still a black and white world, even though we were seeing red all over. Newsreels that ran before the feature showed us frightening images of the growing threat from communist Russia. And when the movie finally started, sometimes its message wasn't all that different. Monster movies in the 50s mirrored our fears that the enemy was coming to destroy our monuments, to change the American way of life. It was around this time that a young man named Bill Turner graduated from college and went looking for a job. He decided to join the FBI.
I was in the FBI here in the San Francisco office in 1952 and 1953. And for most of that time, I was assigned to the wiretaps and bugs that were installed.
At that time, the FBI's targets included labor leaders, lawyers, and suspected institutions, from the California Labor School to the Yugoslavian consulate. And all wiretaps were fed into a converted basement south of Market in San Francisco's produce district.
There were so many leased telephone lines going into the place that the San Francisco police thought it was a bookie joint, and they were about to raid it until I could show my credentials and say, you know, we got something going here. Yeah, there was a moral dilemma, particularly in the area of the bugs. That involved a trespass in order to install, in other words, a burglary. And we're talking about the McCarthy era. You know, at least in the minds of many Americans, anybody who would be a member of any socialist type of group was disloyal to the United States. It was the faulty syllogism.
It was that kind of reasoning that sent Senator McCarthy on his hunt for communists in the State Department.
Were you a member of the Communist Party while you're handling classified material for the government?
I decline to answer the question for the reasons previously given.
As he gained public support, other politicians jumped on the bandwagon and began to question loyalty in every quarter. At the University of California, a new loyalty oath was introduced. Employees had to swear they'd never been a member of the Communist Party. When many teachers refused to sign, it divided the school. Tom Parkinson and Chuck Muscatine had just joined the university then.
Well, I didn't sign because, you have to remember, in those days, Hitler was still very much in our minds in the early 50s and late 40s. And Hitler's professors did not behave very well during the growth of Nazism. And many of us knew that, and many of us felt that it was part of our identity as professors to tell it the way it is and not go along with this hysterical anti-communism.
Tom and Chuck were among the dozens of professors who left the university in protest. 32 others were actually fired for not signing. The professors may have been right, but that didn't make them popular. Public opinion did not come to their rescue.
You have to remember that at that time, you had a vast number of young people who had been through the war, returned, who were busy setting up their houses in the suburbs, buying their station wagons, getting their children to school and back. And if you went to them and said you had a problem and what it was, then nothing compared to the problem of meeting the payments in that station wagon.
Across the bay, at San Francisco's waterfront, fear of the Red Menace was also behind the most famous criminal trial of the time. The United States versus Harry Bridges. He was charged with being a communist. In 1934, the Australian-born Bridges had emerged from the bloody San Francisco dock strike as the leader of the longshoremen. Then, as president of their union, he became an articulate voice for organized labor on the West Coast. He was both a hero among the working men and a target of the maritime establishment. Three times in the 40s, Bridges was accused of and acquitted of being a communist. Then, at the turn of the decade, the government mounted another case, this time claiming Bridges had lied at earlier hearings. On the wharf, the longshoremen were crying, frame up, that it was a government-sponsored attack on their union. San Francisco liberals called it an outrage.
He was the victim of the only bill of attainder ever passed by the United States Congress, that is to pick a particular man out and order his deportation because of his political activities.
Attorney Vincent Hallinan defended Bridges. Hallinan had become something of a legend himself in a few celebrated trials, but he knew he'd face more than a jury in the Bridges case.
Bridges warned me that his lawyers in the other case had all been sentenced to jail in New York, which they had been, and that I might have the same thing, and that he wanted to warn me that he wasn't going to misrepresent the possible penalties. Bridges was an international figure. And this was now the height of McCarthyism, and here Bridges is right at the peak of it. And then the judge, the federal judge, as most of the federal judges are, was just part of the prosecution, did everything he could to bring about a conviction.
Judge George Harris, a man known to be tough on communism, heard the case. He and Hallinan locked horns immediately. And just as Bridges had warned, Hallinan was sentenced to jail for contempt of court before he'd even finished his opening remarks.
That is the whole thing with McCarthyism, the Bridges trial, putting me in prison. If they could do this to Bridges and to me, who had the powers of resistance, what chance is some poor little streetcar conductor? Oh, if they can throw Hallinan into jail for 6 months, they can throw me in for 6 years.
Hallinan's jail term was postponed and the trial went on. 11 witnesses testified against Bridges. Most of them were ex-communists. A few had once testified on his behalf. They were all professionals at taking the stand. They painted a portrait of Harry Bridges as a communist that the jury believed. And on April 5th, 1950, 5 months after the trial began, the labor hero who'd united San Francisco's waterfront was convicted of being a communist. And his lawyer was headed to jail for contempt of court.
They did everything they could to convict poor Bridges, and succeeded. And then the judge, as I say, before the case was over, sentenced me to 6 months in prison in the federal penitentiary.
Whether Bridges was framed became a moot point when 3 years later his conviction was overturned on a technicality. It was about that time that the 32 professors who'd been dismissed at Cal were reinstated, also in a legal technicality. Within a year, Senator McCarthy would take on the U.S. Army, and in doing so, anger the president, discredit himself, and resign. By the time Dwight Eisenhower waltzed through the Republican convention at San Francisco's Cal Palace in 1956, fear of communism at home had receded. But our fear of the Soviet Union was riding high. America was deep in the arms race and no longer the only one with a bomb. When we come back, we'll take a look at how we lived under the threat of nuclear war in San Francisco in the 1950s. We'd heard the news in late 49. The Russians had the atomic bomb. Incredibly, just 4 years after the war to end all wars, the world was back on uncertain terms. And by the early 50s, we were busy building and testing newer,
bigger bombs.
Doomtown, USA is being sacrificed for science. In the two-story house on Main and Elm Streets, the Mannequin family waits 3,500 feet from atomic destruction. 50 cars are on the streets of the ghost hamlet in Nevada. And marching to within 2 miles of the blast center, 1,500 GIs take cover in slit trenches, closer to an atomic explosion than any human since Nagasaki.
That the Bay Area would play a major role in the new arms race was inevitable. The Lawrence Radiation Lab at Cal had helped build the first atomic bomb at Los Alamos. And in 1952, Ernest Lawrence, with another pioneering scientist, Edward Teller, convinced the Defense Department that it should convert an old air station at Livermore into a second atomic weapons lab. Operating in secret, the Livermore lab's first project, codenamed Ruth, barely damaged the shot tower at the Nevada test site. But successful tests followed. By 1956, 9 out of 10 American nuclear bombs were designed here. The Livermore lab added to the strategic importance of the San Francisco Bay Area. And the new arms race meant that we'd have to lead the rest of our lives under the awesome threat of nuclear war.
Val Peterson, Civil Defense Director, warns us to prepare, for one day this could be your house and your window.
As a new mother, and every other new mother, we got involved with PTA, and one of the things that we did in 1958 was to plan an evacuation of the local schools in Broadmoor. We had been told through civil defense and the people who knew such things that Treasure Island might be a target, and they might drop a bomb there, and there would be a certain amount of time, if that happened, that we might be able to save the children. And, he got emotional.
Well, he took him all the way down to Woodside.
Yeah.
Like some herald of doom, early in the 50s, monthly air raid drills were a grim reminder of the nuclear threat. If the bomb came, evacuation was the plan. The new highways were the means. San Francisco's Civil Defense Code called for leaders to direct the operation from a basement at the Yountville Veterans Home. Bill Ward was regional manager for Civil Defense.
These lights represent the various warning conditions. For instance, the yellow alert, when under that condition, it meant that something was going on in terms of some kind of enemy action. That would be the sign for Civil Defense people report in here and get ready to go into action. Then the blue condition was that something was definitely going on. Some overt act had been detected. This would be the condition under which we would begin to evacuate cities and move people out. Then under the red, this meant that the attack was actually in progress, and that was for to take cover.
Ladies and gentlemen, we interrupt this program to bring you important news.
Of course, there's always that suspicion in the back of your mind, just how effective could you be, but there was no other alternative. We had to give it our best shot and hope that what we were doing would save lives.
According to the plan, during an evacuation, all roads were to lead one way, out of town. And 6 million people were to find food and shelter in the farm towns north of Sacramento or south of San Jose.
We did, during the 50s, conducted some practice evacuations, and in Solano County, under a program called Operation Chico, we moved nearly 1,000 people from Fairfield to the city of Chico in an exercise based on this type of planning, and it went quite well.
In fact, Operation Chico was a grand success. Organized, civil, almost fun. Fairfield families spent the night with Chico families, and everyone went home in the morning having made new friends.
Obviously, it was missing a very important element, and that was that people knew that they weren't under enemy attack at the time. You know, thank God we never had to really find out if the plan would work under an actual enemy attack situation, but it was the best that could be done under the circumstances.
But large-scale evacuation plans would soon be shelved.
thanks to new, bigger rockets that could airmail a bomb from so far away we'd never see it coming. It wouldn't be 7 or 8 hours of warning anymore. We'd be lucky to get 20 minutes. Now we were told to look for cover wherever we could.
We must be ready every day, all the time, to do the right thing if the atomic bomb explodes. Duck and cover. That's the first thing to do.
Duck and Cover was the most famous civil defense film of the time. Looking at it now seems to acknowledge the futility of planning for the bomb.
Under the table. It's a bomb. Duck and cover. Duck and cover.
And so, by the middle of the decade, the nuclear bomb had clearly changed the way we looked at our lives. But at the same time, another bit of technology was drastically changing the way we lived our lives. Only it was the automobile. When we come back, we'll take a look at our love affair with a car in San Francisco in the 1950s.
How does it feel to own an Edsel?
It's like falling in love.
Pink Cadillac, going down the road.
Of course, the automobile had been around since before the 20s. Oakland, with the General Motors plant, proudly called itself the Detroit of the West. But cars were always a hard sell here compared to the rest of the country. After all, only ferries crossed the bay until the bridges were built. That was during the Depression. World War II followed, then Korea. It wasn't until the early 50s that the Bay Area bought into America's fascination with the automobile.
I think the funny thing about the cars is, at that time, they were so important. We named our cars.
That was Greeny.
It was Greeny, yeah. And then we had Blue Boy, yeah. You know.
Our
and
first
then we,
automatic yeah. transmission. Wow.
We had one, and we called it the Powder Puff. And that was a little bit later, and it was a nicer. It was a Mercury, and it was a ladies'
hard top.
Car. You know,
cream and
but
orange.
We don't name our cars anymore, so things have changed a little bit.
With families moving to the suburbs, the car found its steadiest customers. But with teenagers, it found its most devoted fans.
This is Jumpin' George, reminding you you're listening to KSAN San Francisco.
McDonald Avenue in Richmond, East 14th in San Leandro, Monterey Road in San Jose. These roads were long. Gas was cheap. Cruising became part of the courting dance.
We cruised Friday night and Saturday night. Maybe 50 to 100 cars following each other. Back and forth, that was it.
Joe Balin cruised in a 41 Chevy back then.
There's always girls. There's, hey, I was with this guy, and I was in this guy's car. And
he also happened to own a shop in Hayward that was something of a shrine for cruisers. Balin's Custom Auto, where they transformed Detroit's best into works of art. Joe Balin became known across the nation as king of the custom cars.
My main one in my whole life was Candiapo red paint. I invented it. I tried to create a paint that was like the curve of a taillight. Now, it's all over the world. They've painted everything. And by mistake, I didn't patent the color. And that makes me still working building custom cars.
But more than a Cadillac culture and drive-through dreams, the most profound effect of the automobile was on our landscape. In 1952, the Bayshore Freeway opened. The following year, plans were unveiled for an integrated system that would rim the bay. Every month seemed to bring another ribbon cutting with another parade of cars. And every month, another rail line closed. Another ferry went to dry dock. The car had proven to be the final link in a great chain of progress that led to life in the suburbs. Right out of the pages of Sunset Magazine. Opportunity moved to the suburbs as well. Cheap land that attracted developers attracted industry. Ford moved to Milpitas. GM left Oakland for the then farmlands of Fremont. Lockheed and Westinghouse broke ground near Stanford for their new homes. With all this movement upward and outward, someone was bound to get left behind in the cities. Predictably, it would be minorities, especially blacks.
I have to say that in this area, the fact that we were all Caucasian, it didn't bother us.
It didn't really occur to us.
It didn't occur to us. In fact, there was a racial covenant for this area, and you could not rent, lease, or house anyone who, frankly, didn't look like us. But we didn't even know, but I think that probably in those days, we probably would have signed it anyway if we had known, because we wanted to get a house.
In 1952, a San Francisco dentist named Dan Collins decided that the suburbs of Mill Valley would be the ideal place to raise his family. He knew that no blacks lived there yet, and that restrictive covenants were still on most of the homes.
The deed on this house, the deed that was signed when we bought the house, it had a restrictive covenant. No pigs, or goats, or farm animals, or orientals, or blacks, except for house servants, could live on this property. But there was no legal reason why we couldn't. And it was a matter of muscling up the courage and doing it.
For Dr. Collins, a suburban home was at least a financial possibility. After all, he was a professional, one of only three black professionals in San Francisco at the time. Most blacks had migrated here during the war to man shipyards and factories. When wartime industries vanished, so did their jobs and the government guarantees of equal opportunity.
Opportunities in the 1950s were very slim because this is the most unionized town in the country. And except for the ILWU, there was really no inroads for blacks into labor unions. There was not a black bellhop or a black bootblack or a black taxi driver, or a black waiter. There were no jobs in this town for blacks.
Most blacks ended up in temporary war housing or in San Francisco's Western Addition, which had been a Japanese neighborhood until wartime internment. The Collins' move to Mill Valley was unprecedented.
Before we moved in, I got a call from a man named Gene Heide, who at that time was a real estate dealer here in Mill Valley. He was supposed to be the liberal real estate dealer, and for that reason he had been assigned the job or the task by his fellow realtors to offer to sell, to buy the house from us at a profit. And I said to him, great, if you'll pay me twice what I paid for the house, no bargaining, I'd be happy to sell it to you. But they didn't take that bait. They didn't call back, and consequently we bought the house and moved in a couple of months later. Now, on the other side, there were many people in Mill Valley who were not distressed by our moving here. My sons don't know of any. You know, they were accepted and lived in Mill Valley without any fear of being, you know, rejected. You had a bunch of people over here in Mill Valley who were much more democratic than a lot of people thought they were.
Integration, desegregation in neighborhoods, in schools, in the workplace would capture the nation's attention by the end of the decade. In 1955, at the University of San Francisco, it will be a couple of young black basketball players who would take the city where it had never been before to a national championship. Two players from that team would go on to be among the greatest to ever play the game, Bill Russell and Casey Jones. Jones remembers taking the floor to start the 1955 season against powerhouse UCLA.
UCLA was eighth in the country as far as ranking goes, and we were like 500. We were not even thought of. And we had no shoes. We just had a bunch of raggedy-looking guys. Now, he talked about being cocky, arrogant, and the whole bit. And we had them 20-3, I guess, in the first 10 minutes. And then we just rolled from there, just rolled over everybody.
And now watch galloping Bill Russell. A classic dribbling job, going the length of the court to score a pair of points for the Dons.
USF coach Phil Wolpert had a Cinderella team led by Jones and his roommate Bill Russell. The Dons went undefeated that year on their way to the national championship tournament in Oklahoma City.
We were mostly black players. And in Oklahoma City, while we were practicing, you know, a lot of spectators come in and watch us. They throw pennies on them, throw dimes at us, and a little bit, Globetrotters, Globetrotters, you know. And what Russell was doing during the course of practice was going around picking it all up. He said, hold this for me, coach. Yeah. And we just rolled through that tournament.
In fact, the Dons rolled right through the next season, too. They didn't lose another game until after Casey and Russell had graduated.
The city of San Francisco opened up its hearts to the all-conquering Dons following their return home with their second straight national championship.
We've done something that no other team had ever done at that time. did fantastic things for San Francisco. Just put it on the map, brought it together. There was a oneness, something to hang our hats on, something to be proud of.
And the city was proud of its team, but not everybody turned out for the games. By the middle of the decade, there was too much else going on. When we come back, a trip to the city's hottest spot, North Beach, as San Francisco in the 1950s continues.
When the clock strikes 12, we'll cool off and start rocking around the clock again. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight.
1955, the year rock and roll burst onto the charts, the year America owned half the world's cars and three-quarters of the kitchen appliances, something was happening in San Francisco's North Beach. In the dark, smoky bars and coffee houses, a cultural revolution was brewing.
It had a great ambiance, had a great feeling. It was like it was a creation. It was something that was being born, a rinascimento, a renaissance. We all called it the Renaissance was happening.
Enrico Banducci was one of the first to sense the changing times. He opened his club, The Hungry Eye, to a new breed of comics, like Mort Saul, and later, Lenny Bruce, whose sharp wit cut into American values and politics as never before.
It was a combination of many things. One, you had four universities around. Two, you had a man like Mort Saul, who started the whole thing with The Hungry Eye, speaking about the universities and about the president and about McCarthy. He was the first one to speak against McCarthy politically. He had a little joke, which it was, he said, have you seen the Eisenhower jacket? He said, it's multi-zippered, zippered here. You zipper here and you pull out maps. You zipper here, you got cigarettes. And you zipper over here and you got pencils and everything else. He said, but aha, they have a new jacket called the McCarthy jacket. It zips up the side and over your mouth. Well, half the audience laughed in those days. The other half says, commies, boo, commies, commies.
On the streets, Italian opera recalled the neighborhood's roots, but suddenly it was blending with the rhythms of jazz. Dick Partee made the trip from the old nightclubs in the Western Addition to North Beach.
There really was a lot going on, and I lived on Grand Avenue. I had a friend of mine, when I wasn't playing, he and I would go out, we'd close the bars, and we'd find a party to go to. And at one point, all the bars along this street, the little Italian bars, would open at 6 in the morning. So we'd close the bars, we'd find a party to go to, and then until 6 o'clock, and then we'd start again at 6 o'clock in the morning. Yes, it was like Saturday night every night.
Clubs sprang up overnight. The Hungry Eye, the eye standing for intellectual, was where the big names played. To break in, you had to go down the block to the Purple Onion. That's what one housewife, mother of five from Alameda, did in 1955. Her name was Phyllis Diller.
I was 37 years old, and believe me, I was a housewife. I was the woman next door, and that's exactly what I looked like, the woman next door. Nobody wants to pay money to see the woman next door. You go next door and look at that dumb broad. Oh, opening night. Boy, was I innocent. You see, I have this black glove that I put on, and I had a man helping me with material. And he suggested cutting one finger out of the black glove. And every time I put the glove on, I got a laugh. And time again, I asked him, I said, why do they laugh at that? Of course, it just happened to be the finger, which I knew nothing about. I knew nothing about that.
Phyllis was a hit. What was supposed to be a 10-day run lasted 89 weeks.
You see, it was the underbelly of the arts that was coming to life in North Beach. It was before the topless thing, invented by Rudy Gernreich in San Francisco. Little shop right there. I will never forget when he introduced that. And that sort of ruined that sort of wonderful highbrow thing. Because then they went with the Carol Doda and the big bassoons and the whole different thing.
The topless North Beach was still a few years away. October 7th, 1955, while Phyllis was at the Purple Onion, another historic debut took place in a converted garage called the Six Gallery, a poetry reading.
I saw the best minds of my generation destroyed by madness, starving, hysterical.
The poem was called Howl by a Berkeley graduate student named Allen Ginsberg. That night, a cross-section of San Francisco's artistic community was on hand, from wealthy art patrons to young poets and writers, like Jack Kerouac, Michael McClure, and Gary Snyder.
Angel-headed hipsters burning for the ancient...
The event seemed to bring together a movement with poetry, its voice. From that day forward, North Beach would be the heart of the Beat Generation.
It has a double meaning. One is beat in the sense of beatific or blessed. And the other is beat in the sense of out of society, and also in the sense of being voluntarily poor.
There was beat poetry, there was beat art, beat film, beat dance, even beat dress, and a beat lifestyle that centered around bars and cafes like the Coexistence Bagel Shop, The Place, The Cellar, Vesuvio's, and the original coffee gallery run by Leo Rigler.
A friend of mine and I, we bought this Miss Tea Room, and there was a big empty room next to it, which was a bakery at one time. And we put a beer and wine license in there, and pretty soon people started coming in, and then the whole beat generation started there. And we put in with jazz and art exhibits and poetry readings, etc., etc.
Well, going to North Beach in those days was quite an adventure. We read about Ferlinghetti and Kerouac, yeah. And we read his
poetry, but we didn't really get involved with him. We didn't have time to roam around.
I remember being moved by it.
I never sat in a coffee house. I don't know if you did, but I just never did.
I don't like
did.
Thick coffee. Hey, baby,
jump over here when you... I would call them rebels rather than revolutionaries. And to some extent, they were putting people on. To give you a silly example, Michael McClure once wrote a poem that had only one word in it, which was repeated for 10 minutes, and the word was light. And it really almost permanently put the audience to sleep. After Mike was through, he asked one of his friends if his friend liked it. The friend thought for a while, and he said, parts of it.
I had questions about whether I was a beat poet or not, but my friends were all beat poets, so I probably was a beat poet. Probably they were all thinking the same thing.
Michael McClure came to San Francisco in 1954. He left his home in Kansas to write in the city famous for Mark Twain, Bret Hart, and Jack London.
I came here for the romance. You have the two factors, the closeness to the Orient, the sights, smells, tastes, touches of Chinatown and of the Orient, right and literally at the edge of North Beach. And you had a proximity to nature. Here you could get in an old car where the doors didn't work right, because nobody's car doors ever shut right in those days, and the tires were bald, but you could drive to the top of Mount Tamalpais. And you could see the Pacific Ocean, and you could think other thoughts.
Frequently, those other thoughts were not what the rest of America was thinking. The beat lifestyle was so different, it got the attention of those who weren't, including the police. In 1957, Howl, that Ginsberg poem that started it all, was printed by Lawrence Ferlinghetti's City Lights bookstore. But on the way back from the presses, a shipment was seized by U.S. customs officials who declared the poem obscene. Later, police arrested Ferlinghetti and his partner for selling copies. The spirited Howl trial lasted the summer and ended in a landmark decision, finding that the controversial poem indeed had redeeming social value. The trial added to the North Beach mystique, as did Jack Kerouac's classic saga of American youth on the road, much of which was written here. Unfortunately, publicity was not necessarily what the Beats were after.
By 1958, I realized I couldn't stay in North Beach anymore. It was filled with tourists coming to look at people like us. We'd become an industry, I literally had to leave.
Tourists came in to look at the beatniks came in to look at the tourists. It was like Saturday night, every night of the week. One time was really funny, seeing beatniks and Wade downtown, you know, made the headlines and everything. They went down to Union Square with the bongo drums, marched through the lobby of the San Francis Hotel, you know, it freaked everybody out.
That event, dubbed the Squaresville Tour, was really the last gasp for San Francisco's beat scene. In North Beach, as the Gray Line bus tours moved in, the literary figures moved out. Many of the coffee houses closed. And although clubs remained on Broadway, they'd soon go topless and force virtually everything else off the marquee. it was quite a coup in 1958, a Major League Baseball team. And that our San Francisco Giant came from New York, well, that only added to what most of us saw as the latest status symbol for the city.
It was major. The town went crazy. That's all anybody talked about. And of course, Seal Stadium was an especially attractive place to watch baseball because it was small, comfortable, well-built, and then very close to the action. For 2 years, I think we all found a way to get out to the game somehow or other, almost every day. And we loved Willie Mays and adored Orlando Cepeda, and these were our heroes.
Opening day, our boys soundly trounced the new Los Angeles Dodgers 8-0, and the rivalry was underway. The Giants won 83 games that year. They also won our hearts. Maybe that's because the team arrived when so many other things we'd taken for granted were disappearing. As the 1950s neared their end, America's economy slumped for the first time since the Depression. What's worse, the Russians beat us into space and further confounded us when their evil leader, Nikita Khrushchev, on a visit to San Francisco, at least gave the impression of not being very evil at all. Meanwhile, in the South, clashes over civil rights grew steadily worse and raised more and more questions about our democracy. Everywhere, it seemed, the world was becoming more complicated. For San Francisco, the changing times came home when the House Un-American Activities Committee scheduled hearings at City Hall. They were greeted by protesters, young, educated students, willing to take a stand, willing to go to jail. This was a different generation than the one who'd settled down here 10 years before. And the event was a signpost of what was to come in the next decade. But what endures is our image of San Francisco in the 1950s. The war in the 40s had opened up our city. The turbulence of the 60s would rock its very foundation. Maybe that explains the growing nostalgia for the 1950s, the decade when San Francisco, like so many of us, started to grow up. We hope you've enjoyed our look back at San Francisco in the 1950s, and that you'll join us when Bobby Menis takes us back to San Francisco in the 1960s. I'm Evan White.
San Francisco in the 50s was brought to you by Swanson Frozen Foods. When you're not home cooking, Swanson is. And by Nissan, who invites you to see the complete line of Nissan cars and trucks at your nearest Nissan dealer. Nissan, built for the most important race of all, the human race. And by Chevron and high-octane Chevron Supreme Unleaded, the high-performance premium gasoline with Tecraline. Chevron Supreme, yes.
Rockin' Robin, what we really gonna rock up tonight?